Hello and welcome to News Click. I'm Nilanjan Mukhopadhyay, and you're watching Present, Past and the Future. In just a matter of few days, we will know who governs India for the next few years. Over the past several elections, the quality of our electoral narrative has been on a tailspin. But there has been something absolutely rotten about 2019 campaign. This time, there has been a radical rupture from the past. The pretense of commitment to inclusiveness has disappeared, and the semblance of impartiality in the electoral process has evaporated. For the past several months, we have heard people's apprehensions of elections being subverted. These fears were not at all allayed by the only institution which could do so, the Election Commission of India. As the campaign draws to a close, it is time to recall some of the new lows and the worries that arise from these. To discuss the campaign, which is fading into history, I am joined by two fearless academicians. My first guest is Hilal Ahmed, who has very recently written a book called Siyasi Muslims, A Story of Political Islam in India, and Ajay Gudavarthy, a very eminent political scientist with the Jawaharlal Nehru University. First of all, we should have ideally had this conversation in Khan Market, not in a studio, in the News Click studio. Like always, we will begin this program with my three theses, you know, and the first thesis or hypothesis which I call is I'm going to put it open for discussion. This is that in 2014, the BJP's campaign fronted development but was inlaid with Hindutva. This time, the facade has been done away with. There has been very little talk of Vikas or development, and the emphasis was on Vinash or destruction of the nation if the BJP is not voted back into power. Hilal, let me begin with you. We obviously agree that this has been a campaign of new lows. From your point of view, how do you see that, what do you think were the biggest symptoms of it touching the nadir, if it really does not become worse in subsequent elections?
I think that it has to do with the nature of competitive electoral politics and country. And we have to understand that the meaning of success in a society has changed dramatically. Now, success means you have to achieve something, no matter what means you have used. And this is the moral value of society. This is clearly reflected in competitive electoral politics. Now, there are two or three aspects of it, which new lows which you are talking about. One is that all political parties, and particularly BJP, they have started identifying the core constituency of their own. And they are keen that the vote of the core constituency should reach to them. In order to provoke them, they are, you know, relying on anti-Muslim discourse, which they have been doing openly. That is one. Second is that the discourse of majoritarianism has already established. So to target Muslim or to link Hindutva with nationalism, it becomes very, very simple and very straightforward.
It becomes a triangle. You know, you have a muscular nationalism, you have an anti creating an Islamophobia, and then you also bring in those people who are opposed to your policies.
Yeah, and the third and the most important aspect is, and which is my worry, I don't think that anti-Muslim discourse is going to survive for a long period of time. That is the anti-intellectual discourse in this campaign. This Khan Market thing which you just mentioned is something has to do with that. that we need to just make fun of people who are seriously involved in academic activities, and therefore creating popularism of a different kind. So that's the third thing which is contributing to the entire electoral discourse.
Ajay, Hilal was very optimistic when he said that he does not see this blind anti-Muslim politics surviving beyond a certain point, and he sees that possibly evolving into a very strong anti-intellectual discourse. This has been the push, in fact, over the last 5 years. You know, we have not actually ever seen a campaign where the Prime Minister has reduced everything to saying tukde tukde gang. You know, a university protest becomes the metaphor for everything which is wrong against their idea of nationalism. How do you look at what all has happened, and especially in the context of this campaign?
No, I think taking on from the tukde tukde gang, I think it's a very interlinked discourse. Yeah. They are contemporizing in one sense what Golwalkar did. If you look at the urban Naxal discourse closely, and if you decode it, the way they have connected those who were arrested linked to tukde tukde gang, linked to Maoists. So that stands for the communist in what Golwalkar said. The Maoists were in turn linked, somebody like Gautam Nawalaka being arrested, to Kashmiri Jihadi, which is the Muslim face. Part of the problem of the RSS is that the Indian Muslim today no longer fits that kind of militant, vigorous, violent kind of a Muslim that they want. Now that can only fit with the Kashmiri kind of resistance, because the Indian Muslim is not resisting. He is playing an intelligent game of being silent, either co-opted or silent, and playing according to the democracy. Their number game is what they are buying. And third, in urban Naxal, they also arrested two human rights activists from Bombay, who were both Christians. So this old narrative of Muslim, Christian, communist being three enemies, I think continues. They're interconnecting that discourse. The point is how much of these very intricate kind of connections they can carry it at a much mass popular level of building this kind of a sustained narrative. Now, it can localize prejudices, can exist and disappear, but can it emerge into a sustained national narrative? I think the testing point was Kashmir this time. If you see the case of Kashmir, this government under this 5 years, they kept it burning, and it was on the headlines all through, because Kashmiri Muslim stands for a pan-Indian kind of an emotion, which the Indian Muslim no longer is able to provide that kind of polarization, because he is almost a vanquished adversary now.
We do see instances outside Kashmir, especially during festive occasions, during the month of Ramzan, as we are currently facing, after the evening iftar. You know, you find young Muslims moving around in bands, or on the night of Shab-e-Barat, you see them moving and coming into spaces which are otherwise denied to them on occasions of Eid. So there is a conflict at that time, but thereafter they retreat into their ghettos. So the ghettoization has happened in the last 5 years.
Yeah, absolutely. That old resistance no longer exists, because they simply do not have that social power or those economic resources. So I think the problem is, for a majority muscular nationalism, you also need the other, who is as strong, as vocal. So if you see OYC, I think is only symbol today they have in Indian Muslim case, who is able to retort, which I don't really approve the way he actually problematizes many of the issues, which I think is what the muscular majority nationalism requires.
Hilal, you have talked about Muslims, Muslim political representation in India. You have consistently argued that the number of legislators or parliamentarians is not the true indicator as to the level of participation. You have consistently argued as to how Muslim participation has gone up in the sense of rising Muslim voting data which is available. Now, what does this show? At one level, you are being pushed out of the mainstream. The ruling party does not even pretend to accept your existence. You know, sabka saath, sabka vikas is just another jumla. It is no way, there is no attempt on part of Mr. Modi to become what I call, you know, sabka neta. It is just used only to become so that he is kuch ka neta. He wants to be the leader of only one section. Now, despite this, you know, and what Ajay was saying, you know, that they have kind of retreated, being almost a vanquished community. Do you share this view?
I think when we talk about Muslim, we must realize we are talking about huge number of people.
Yeah, right.
And they are, you know, they live in different areas, they live in different regions,
and
states.
Not a
there's
community.
Not at all homogeneous community. Yeah,
exactly.
And we have to also look at the north-south divide.
Yes, exactly.
Ajay must be well aware of
right.
that than me.
Yeah.
When we talk about this heterogeneity, we have to look at the, we have to look at a two level. One is the discourse level. Mm. Certainly, at the discourse level, anti-Muslim discourse has been established. But in terms of the actualities of politics, we have to look at in different context.
Mm.
Now, look at the discourse level, what sort of issues they raised in last 5 years. Ghar Vapsi, Ayodhya, Love Jihad, and most importantly, beef. And beef, I won't consider into this because that's a different and a specific issue.
Mm.
And most importantly, Ram Temple.
Mm.
All of these issues, or triple talaq, all of these issues did not have that resonant within the Muslim community.
Mm.
For instance, Ayodhya, obviously there is a temple there for last, since 1992-93, any Hindu can go and perform worship.
Now, even before that, Muslims couldn't go
yes.
and
so that was a
Namaz
non-issue
yeah.
For Muslims. Triple talaq, there was an overwhelming opposition to this practice, and that's
within the community.
Within the community, and then many members of All India Muslim Personal Law Board resigned just because of the stand they
exactly.
took on that. Look at Ghar Vapsi, it was highly complicated issue because they were not Ari Samaj.
Mm.
They were not going to do Shuddhi.
Mm.
So it was a defeating thing. And finally, Love Jihad. Because when this anti-Romeo squad was created in UP, many of the people who caught were not Muslims.
The problem is not just about what has been done by the BJP. It's
no,
about
but
the social profiling which is done.
So the thing is that because these were not the issues which actually provoked, at least in North India, Muslim too.
Mm.
The BJP, these were not, you know, creating kind of a social atmosphere of some kind.
Right.
That's one. But this lynching thing,
the
car vigilante and beef was very, very different.
Yeah.
It was a low economy thing. Means you need not to create a kind of a big riot.
Hmm.
You have to just kill a few people and create an impact, which
right.
they did.
And
as
it
a result,
gives a sense of triumphalism
yes, so
within the Hindus.
The fair psyche was created through this only.
Yeah.
And as a result, the silences of Muslims must be interpreted with regard to these issues differently.
Hmm.
So all four issues which I just narrated were different from the lynching issue.
Right.
And as a result, the silence was obvious because this is not our issue, so why should I respond to that? But lynching somehow created a fear among Muslims. So if you ask me what is the most important and dominant Muslim issue at the moment is fear.
That's right. Very important. Now let us move to the second thesis of mine in this program, where I say that populist authoritarianism and pragmatic communalism has not been new to India. It has been ushered in earlier during the Indira Gandhi tenure. But over the past 5 years, we have witnessed a transition to authoritarian majoritarianism and programmatic communalism. We now have a government which is a democracy in name, but it is very much a democracy of just the few. A classical ethnic democracy, if one can actually call it, which is driven by the idea of majoritarianism. How would you?
No, that's true. But I think one has to also deconstruct and decode that this majoritarianism that looks pan-national and it's a national also is linked to multiple micro-narratives in each context.
Right.
For instance, the way it's linked to the way that subdividing caste in UP and Bihar.
Hmm.
And they are subdividing caste on one hand. That subdivision of Dalits and OBCs is also in a very curious way leading to a more appetite for muscular Hindutva.
Hmm.
So the for purpose of representation, you are a Dalit. For purposes of recognition, you are a Hindu.
Mm-hmm.
So I think this kind of a micro narrative, we have to get into those details.
Mm-hmm.
I think simply calling it majoritarianism.
Mm-hmm.
Similarly with the Muslim question, Hilal already pointed out from the Muslim point of view.
Mm-hmm.
From the populist point of view too, we have to understand what is it that justifies this kind of a muscular ghettoization or subjugation of the Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
Is they're building on a deep sense of historical injury. that there has been a historical injury. Muslims are not victims, they were a ruling elite. Urdu was an official language. Look at the whole Sabarimala issue. Sabarimala issue is nothing but a kind of a minoritization of Hindus. So you had personal laws, so Muslim-based, faith-based practices were given a certain privilege. While from the days of Hindu code bill, Hindu faith-based practices were open to constitutional scrutiny. So that is the narrative they are trying to build. So Sabarimala is an upturning. So Sabarimala followed the triple talaq. So the point they are trying to make to the majority Hindus is that now we will open up Muslim faith-based cultural practices to constitutional. That's a question of individual justice. Well, Sabarimala is a faith-based practice where constitution has no business or judiciary has no business to intervene. This, I think, looks very reasonable. This looks like a sense of achieving a justice, like something that is setting wrong for an historical injury that happened on Hindus. So I think simply critiquing it as majoritarian, I don't think would help us. We'll have to think what is the narrative at the local level that we can generate. And these are multiple narratives, Nilanjan, at each level I can see, linked to caste, neoliberalism, faith-based religious practices. So today it is upturned. Hindu feels a sense of deep sense of victimhood and feels Muslim is an aggressor. While in social terms, we know where Muslims stand. So this kind of optics, which has upturned the entire logic, how do we address this? And that is what is leading to a populist authoritarian consent.
You know, there is linked with this, there is also this narrative which has been created that all this sentiment which the system of looking at things and the equations which exist has been justified because of institutions which has quote unquote appeased the minorities. There is a consistent argument that there is appeasement not just from the political parties, you know, which are the non-BJP political parties, but also the constitutional institutions of the country. We have in the last 5 years seen that the integrity of these institutions come under a lot of pressure. In the course of this election, we have seen, I was referring to how the election commission has behaved, and this is by and large been justified by the people. You will not find many people thinking that you know, the EC has been kinder to the BJP or Mr. Modi or Amit Shah. You know, does it also mean that there is added pressure from a majoritarian culture on institutions to change themselves and be more attuned to this version of nationalism?
I think just taking this point from Ajay, because he's making a very, very crucial point that, you know, how some kind of a narrative is constructed and how this narrative is placed in the public discourse. Now, for instance, we question the authority of, say, Supreme Court with regard to Sabarimala, the same kind of triple talaq issue will be, you know, brought in.
Right.
Now, the question is that this tit-for-tat attitude, and it reminds me on a lighter note, this famous Diwar thing, pehle uska naam likh kar aao jisne mere naam. So, that has become the narrative. So, and you know, this has been the strategy of this government. Since 2014, they have been questioning the opposition on their own, on the way they are being questioned. So, in my view, the larger point is that, remember that institution, and this is, I think, a problem of our own secular politics, secular constitutional politics. We have somehow started worshipping the constitution. Constitution is not made up of ideas. It is practiced by people. So, if the morality of the people is going to decline, how can we expect that the institution will do justice? Because end of the day, these are peopled by people like us. So, therefore,
but the constitution has been put on a pedestal by this government. Mr. Modi said
even
that
then
it's a holy book.
But that's the problem. Because if you freeze the constitution, their attempt is to freeze it by saying that this is a holy book. Now, the counter argument should be that this is not a holy book, it's a man-made book. And therefore, it is
open
subject
to scrutiny.
Amendment and criticism. So, that openness somehow reduced from the public discourse.
But they too would like to amend it at some point for their benefit.
I don't think that they are going to create Hindu Rashtra without constitution. They are going to use constitution to create Hindu Rashtra.
Right. They are going to use techniques. They are going to bring in changes to the constitution so that they can do a lot of things.
I don't think that they are going to do changes in the constitution. In my view, the existing frame of the constitution itself is adequate for them to transform the policies which they want, they favorable for the creation of Hindu Rashtra. Right. Remember Bhagwat's all three lectures,
right,
where he said that, you know, we are uncomfortable with the idea of minority. But at the same time, if you look at the constitution does not define who is the minority.
Well, it is time for me to present my third thesis, you know, which is that regardless of the outcome of the elections, reclaiming the republic will be an arduous task. You don't require to be told as to why if the BJP returns to power. But even if there is an alternative government, if it assumes office, it will not be an easy task. The value on the y-axis of an imaginary index of Hindutva is higher than ever before. Let's try to plot an imaginary index of Hindutva where we have x-axis the number of years and we go back to 1971. You can decide your starting point. For me, it is going to be possibly 86. The Shah Bano case and the opening of the lock. From that point, if we actually plot on the y-axis how Hindutva has risen, it has risen very sharply between 2014 and 2019. It did not, to my mind, decline very much between 2004 and 2014. So, which means that there is a growing support for the idea of Hindutva as an ideology. Do you agree with this? And that, can we in any way, or what steps can be taken to reverse this?
I think two things. I like the manner in which someone like Shashi Tharoor came out with the formulation that Hinduism is different from Hindutva.
Political Hindutva.
Political Hindutva. But I think they lack something. That now the difference between Hinduism and Hindutva is crucial, because Hindutva is not merely an idea. It is a practice now.
Right.
But Hinduism, the kind of Hinduism Shashi Tharoor underlines, is not remain a practice. So
it
therefore,
become a ritual.
There become a ritual. Therefore, some kind of the practice which Gandhi did with Hinduism is needed. And I'm really sorry that I do not find that practice at all in our political culture. Why? Because for that, you need social movement kind of politics, not the electoral politics. The problem with Tharoor
is
that
social movement
meaning you, because we are, you know, overemphasizing on electoral politics as if that everything is going to be, you know, the source is constitution or electoral politics. No, there is something called society or social where movements are found. And one of the crucial aspect is to raise the issue of religion in a positive way as a movement. That is not happening. And that is the reason why everything is reduced to election, 2019, etc. And that's the reason why but remember, Hindutva is a practice. It is not merely confined to electoral politics. I can give you one example. Indraprastha, VHP has actually appropriated all the Ramlila committees in Delhi.
Right.
They were not the case earlier. I'm from Delhi, I know that. But now, when you think of any of the organized religious activities, you find
they're
that
all under
it is
the control
all,
of the Sangh Parivar.
So, there should be, there is a need to evolve an intellectual critique of Sangh Parivar. At the same time, you need to evolve a new practice of religion, which is completely different from the hatred kind of politics which Sangh
then
Parivata.
Why do people critique attempts like say Mamata Banerjee's of or of what the left front used to do of taking over the Durga Puja committees in Bengal?
No, but there is a difference between the Durga Puja committee, because if I remember correctly, that always celebrated as a part of culture.
Yeah, it not
religion at all.
It's an occasion to eat.
Occasion to eat, certainly.
Yeah.
But in this case, it is a kind of a political program. And this political program is somehow very categorically in a straightforward way, you know, imbibed through these, VHP committees.
Right. Post May 23rd, what's your prognosis? Where are we going? Forget what kind of government is going to be. We are not in any way in a capacity to to make any guesses.
I think the social consent and consensus has really shifted to the right. That's right. The worrying part. Whichever government, I mean, while it's an important issue, it stands out, but I don't think that our discourse or our struggle, I think, ends with that, even if we have an alternate government.
Definitely.
The bigger question is,
if there's an alternate, a new struggle begins.
Yeah, new struggle begins, but I don't think the alternate has that kind of narrative, as I see, in the popular domain.
Or the political commitment.
Even if there is, I mean, political commitment has to be backed by the right kind of politics and a political discourse. The real crisis, I don't think, is merely political commitment, but the real crisis is, I think, the missing secular narrative, which has an appeal at the popular domain. It has an appeal in circles like ours. We can continue to discuss, you know.
PLUs that we call, you know.
PLU, yeah. I think in that sense, Modi's Khan market job thing works. That there has been this kind of a social divide. And therefore, I think BJP, one has to take their discourse more seriously than what we did earlier. In terms of, they have been able to occupy that anti-elitist local cultural idiom very strongly. So I think everything has turned upside down. You know, that logic of things have turned upside down. The point that, you know, Hilal was making in terms of Hinduism has to be a new signification. See, what is the challenge for that kind of a discourse? If you look at the Dalit OBC politics today in much of the Hindi heartland, they do not want, they are pro-Hindutva. There has been a lot of shift amongst.
Yes.
But if you ask for a positive signification of Hinduism, they say we are not Hindus.
Absolutely.
See, this kind of a new challenge, I think Hindutva is able to shift the very terms of discourse in a very big way. Our old terms of discourse, old social categories, especially in the secular social science discourse, I feel are almost redundant. I think there's no point in analyzing and imposing that. They're only superimposing on that reality. We'll have to now generate a new secular discourse that has an appeal in the popular domain. What that means, which has to be beyond constitution, which has to take into this whole institutional language that you are asking the previous. Look, the whole institutions are a result of the collapse of the developmental state, that these institutions did not deliver. And therefore, right has very rightfully occupied a space that is anti-institutional, which comes from a wide range of anger from Dalits, OBCs, including Muslims, you know, because these institutions have been closed. They cater to the interest of a certain caste Hindu, which is what we are referring symbolic as Lutyens, Delhi and whatever. But that there is a sociological reality and they are tuning in. So they're re-signifying right anger for wrong purpose. And they will divert it to their Hindu Rashtra, hatred, mob lynching and all of this. But all of this has some real sociological basis. And post-neoliberalism, this discontent has got exaggerated multiple fold.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons, I think, there's a purposive direction in the economic policy. People think it is just, I think, to disempower people. And their argument, the more the people are disempowered, the more they feel they will be able to generate a kind of consent for. So we will have to really dig into that real crisis. Beyond the optics of what they're doing. They want us to be caught in this optic. Institutions,
but we have to look beyond. You know, one of the things is what they've been very successful is that in the last 5 years, that they've barraged us with one narrative after another, that by the time you're able to formulate your thoughts on one narrative, they've already shifted terrain to another ground. You know, so you leave your arguments incomplete on the first terrain, but then you have to move and grapple with the next particular field too. Hilal, to end up, you know, last word from you. You were talking about Muslim fear, you know, the fear within the Muslims. The Muslim society, you know, outside of Jammu and Kashmir, you know, Ajay made a point that the Muslim in Jammu and Kashmir has to be dealing from the rest of the country. It's post-fear. Post-fear Muslims, where do they go from here? You can do nothing. The fear is there.
Yeah. Yeah.
But they still live. So what can one expect?
See, because I see things in a positive light, and I think that if you look at the kind of emphasis is given on, say, education and employment, is something which is, you know, if you go to any part of India and talk to Muslims, they would say that we need
we
to be
educated
and we need employment.
Right.
And they are, you know, they are not interested in raising old issues. So this is actually a new empowerment narrative which is coming out slowly and gradually. Fortunately, we don't have such a
But then they'll eventually want political space.
No, but fortunately, we don't have such a commission. Mm. The aura which is created through such a commission by UPA1 and UPA2 has gone. UPA, even the Congress is not interested in such
no
now. So the real question in front of Muslim is that how to be accommodated in the realm of education and employment.
Right.
I don't think that the question of politics will certainly come late, because I analyze the kind of political responses which we got of Muslims in post in Modi era, post 2014.
Right.
And we find that the options are always open. Even a sizable number of Muslims also prefer to vote to BJP many cases.
Yes.
So it means that, look at the BJP's, from BJP's perspective, they have created a narrative that Muslims don't vote us. But if you look at the bottom level of society, if you look at the constituency level, you find that Muslims are preferably approached by the BJP candidate. Simply to actually.
So, what is happening at the national level need not necessarily be happening at the local level, because the candidate at times is interested in his particular victory or, you know, ensuring that he doesn't get lost, and is not always focusing on the party's long term agenda, because he has a much shorter agenda. He's looking at his immediate election.
But Nilanjan, can I make a point?
Yes.
See, look at what happened to such a report.
Yeah.
Government did not give that up. It's a part of their official policy. They always submit an action taken report to Sachar every year.
Yes.
So it means that to keep Sachar
but
at
the
national
level. But that is the politics
level,
of the BJP's token.
Exactly. So to keep the Sachar alive will help them to create.
To consolidate the
Hindu
majority vote. That's what exactly they do. So they constantly keep on referring to the Muslims only because they can get the majority of the Hindu population there. Well, thank you, you know, the two of you. It's really been, we can, actually talk about this for a much longer period of time, but we have, I think it's time for us to wind up. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
For coming and joining me. These are indeed very worrying times. In days to come, we will know if we can breathe a bit easy or not. Till then, remain hopeful of a verdict that is in sync with our composite culture and inclusive spirit. Thank you very much for watching this program.